seen the glory. I've seen my Jesus is standing at the right hand of the Father, wanting to welcome you. And he became steadfast, and all the stones they threw at him, all that did not matter anymore. When you see the glory, and when you see that heavenly home, all the things they do, all the things they say, whatever they act, whatever it is, will not matter to you anymore. There will be a single-minded pursuit of that heavenly home that you see. Look at Luke chapter 9 and see the attitude of Jesus, and see the attitude you ought to have when you know there's a new Jerusalem. There is a heavenly Jerusalem. There is a glorious city whose foundation is made by God himself. When you know there is an eternal, everlasting, glorious heavenly home for you to get to, your mind will be there, your heart will be there, everything within you will be driving towards that point. In Luke chapter 9, reading from verse 51, and it came to pass when the time was come that he should go, and he should be received up, he steadfastly set his face to go to Jerusalem. It wasn't Jerusalem that was the final destination, it was heaven. I'm going back to the Father. He told his own disciples, I said, I'm going back to the Father, and you appear sorrowful. You should have been happy. You should have been happy. He was thinking about the glory he had with the Father from all eternity. He was thinking about the worship of all those angels and the sight of all those angels before he came to the world. He was thinking of the beauty of heaven, the peace in heaven. He was thinking about the joy in heaven. He was thinking about how all those myriads of angels will welcome him. And he steadfastly set his face to be received up, going through Jerusalem. That's how you set your face. That's how you set your mind. That's how you set your focus. That's how you set your life. That's how you pursue with single-mindedness, knowing there's a place called heaven and you want to be there. Look at Hebrews chapter 12. Hebrews chapter 12, and I'm reading from verse 22. There's a place called heaven. Innumerable angels are there, and great joy is there. Hebrews chapter 12, reading from verse 22. In verse 22, but here I come unto Mount Zion and unto the city of the living God. Stop right there. Unto the city of the living God. Think about that. The eternal God, the city where he lives, that's called heaven. Unto the city of the living God. And there's no evil there, there's no sin there, there's no sickness there, there's no suffering there, there's no night there. Everything is light, everything is glory and glorious, everything is wonder and wonderful, everything is joy and joyful, everything is peace and peaceful. It says it's the city of the living God, and that's where we're going. And when you think about that, and you compare this world with heaven, and you compare this country with the heavenly country, and you compare all the things you could have here, you compare that with the glorious land, your mind will leave this place and your mind will not be here. All you want to do is, what can I do to add to my joy when I get there? What can I do to add to my reward when I get there? What can I do to add to my appreciation of God when I get there? It says it is a heavenly city where God himself is living, the heavenly Jerusalem, and to an innumerable company of angels, to the general assembly and the church of the firstborn, which are written in heaven. You want to make sure that your name is there. You want to make sure that there's a record for you and a record concerning you in heaven. You want to make sure that your name is already gone before you, so that now you are coming, and as you get to the gate, they check the register of heaven. They say his name is there, her name is there, and then the angels will welcome you. Your mind should be thinking of that. That should be your pursuit. Single-mindedly saying, that's where I'm going. That's where I want to be. I pray you'll be there in Jesus' name. And that's why it says in Colossians chapter 3, single-minded pursuit, single-minded pursuit after or through or towards this heavenly home. In Colossians chapter 3, Colossians chapter 3, I'm reading from verse 1. If ye then be risen with Christ, if you are born again, if ye then be risen with Christ, something happened before you are risen with Christ. Crucified with Christ. I am crucified with Christ. Not only that, you are dead with Christ. Not only that, you are buried with Christ, and now you are risen with Christ. One, crucified with Christ. I'm crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. And yet, not I, but the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. You cannot be risen with Christ until the self nature is crucified, until that inbred nature is crucified. But now you're crucified with Christ, and then you have died with him. The world is not important so much to you, and all the things in the world, they're not of interest to you. You are dead to them. You are dead to their smoking. You are dead to their drunkenness. You are dead to all their festivities. They do not attract you, as those things do not attract a dead man. Crucified with him, dead with him, and then you are buried with him. You've gone through that water of baptism. You are immersed in the water. It's a burial that it demonstrates there. You are buried with him, and now you rise in newness of nature. You rise in newness of life. And it says, if ye then be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above. Seek those things which are above, instead of concentrating your life on seeking the mundane things of this life, instead of concentrating your life on seeking the things that will vanish away, and the things that will soon perish, and the things that will be burnt in fire eventually. Seek those things which are above, where Christ sitteth on the right hand of God. Set your affections on things above. Like you set a wristwatch, set your affections on things above. Like you set a compass to face just one direction, set your affections on things above. Set your mind, redirect your mind, turn your mind. Let it point at heavenly things. Let it point at things that will last forever. You set your affections on things above. Check up in your life. Is there somebody you set your affection on? You love him so much that it will be so painful for you to divide or to separate yourself from him, and yet it's the one that is leading you in the direction of perdition and suffering and hell. Get your mind away from that and reset your mind, and set your mind on things above. Is there a woman that has so arrested your heart, arrested your soul, captured your life, and you set your affection on that woman? And if that woman, once that woman begins to cry, then you cannot take your stand anymore and says, you are leaving me. If you leave me, I will die. If you leave me, if we don't continue this relationship, then that means my life is over. I will write a note and I will say, so and so is the one that caused my death. I will commit suicide. And because of that, you are attached to sin, attached to fornication, attached to adultery. You get your mind away from that woman. Don't let her take you to hell. It says you will set your mind on things above, and you will. Then that's what the Lord wants us to do. Instead of, you know, you're a jellyfish, you don't have a strong mind, you don't know where you are going, you don't know the condition that is going to get you to heaven, and you do not know what those people are doing, it makes you so attached to them, associated with them. You don't have a free mind, and you cannot say, this is where I am going. But you come today and you say, enough is enough. I am going to get to heaven. Somebody there is going to get to heaven. I said, somebody there is going to get to heaven. You're going to take your heart from them. You're going to take your affection from them. You're going to take your destiny from them. You're going to take your interest from them. You know, if I don't see him in a day, it's like I'm dying. And they say, what do I have on earth if I don't see her? What do I have on earth if I don't see him? That's the danger. That's the trap. That's the trap. And you take your mind away from those things that are so essential to you, indispensable to you, and say, now I set my affection on things above and not on things on the earth. For you are dead, and your life is seed with Christ in God. When Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then shall ye also appear with him in glory. That's what the Lord is calling us to. That's what the Lord is telling us. And he's saying, you must do something steadfastly. You set your affection steadfastly. You're looking towards that goal and towards the place you're going. That's how to get there. And because, you know, there is something beyond the grave. There's something beyond this world. Philippians chapter 3. Philippians chapter 3, I'm reading from verse 7. It says, but what things were gained to me, those things I counted loss for Christ. That's a single-minded man. That's a person pursuing something. He said, I count them, number one, I couldn't do without that before. Number two, I couldn't live without that before. I will feel empty. I will feel life is over. I will feel there's nothing to live for on earth if I didn't have that thing. They were gain to me. They were profitable for me. They were essential for me. They were almost indispensable to my existence. It may be a small thing. It may be a big thing. Something that has held your heart, captured your heart, captured your life. And everything, every time you think, you're saying, I thank God I have that. I thank God I have that. If I didn't have that, how would I live? If I didn't have that, how would I ever be joyful? Paul the apostle said, that thing was making me look downwards. That thing was making me look at sand and cement. That thing was attaching me to the things on this earth. They were profitable, and they were gain to me. He said, because now I see the glory, because now I see that heaven, because I see where I am going very clearly, I jettisoned them, I threw them away. He said, but the things, what things were gain to me, those I counted loss for Christ. You know, sometimes it's an illiterate girlfriend, so-called. Sometimes it's a brute of a man that doesn't even have any fine means at all that captures your interest. Sometimes it's a stranger you are meeting for the first time, and that person is giving you, showing you things that glitter, but they are not gold. Sometimes it's a position, it's not even in your hand yet, and they are promising you that political position. And then they say, but before you have this, you must go through some rituals. Before you have this, you must go through some occultism. Before you have this, you must change your religion. And that position becomes so great to you, you've not even got it yet. It's not in your hand yet. And the thing is going to take you from heaven. And Paul the apostle said, but what things were gain unto me, those I counted loss for Christ. Yea, doubtless, and I count all things. I count all things. Things of the past, things of the present, things of the future. I've made up my mind already. When they come, I say, no, they are done, they are dross, they are useless, they are worthless. I know what I want. I know where I'm going. I know what I'm going to get. It says, doubtless, I count all things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things. He said, but no regrets, no remorse, no going back. He said, I'm not regretting that. The position I had was the Sanhedrin. Voluntarily, I gave it up. The position I had in the religion of my forefathers, voluntarily, I gave it up. The position I had with traditionalists. Paul the apostle said, no big deal, I've given it up. Have you given anything up? Are they so important to you? that they are tying you down. Are they so important to you? You cannot make up your mind. You cannot pursue heaven. All these things that will perish your time, they're so important to you. Paul the apostle said, not me, not me. I count them as loss for Christ. I've suffered the loss of all things, and don't count them, but don't, that I may win Christ. That's a pursuit, single-minded pursuit towards that heavenly home. You know, sometimes you don't know how your life is going to be, whether you have long time or short time. But at this your age now, if you were to have something already, and some of us have been born again now for 20 years, for 30 years, for 40 years, for 50 years, and when you were first born again, you threw away all those things, and your people knew, the villagers knew, your townspeople knew, that man, that woman, only for heaven. At this age, after 20 years of being in Christ, the things that you have dropped, the things that held no hold upon your life, and the things that, even though the people in the country is important, politics or any other thing, the things you jettisoned and rejected before, at this age now, you're picking it up again. Is that not backsliding? Are you not going back to your vomit? Are you not going back to the thing you said no to many years ago? But Paul the apostle said, when I say goodbye to anything, anybody that brings that thing back, I tell him, don't you know who I am? My constitution, my conviction, my consecration, my devotedness to the Lord. I said bye-bye 20 years ago. 20 years have come and gone. I still say that same thing, bye-bye, because I have counted them as dung and dross and refuse, and I'm not going to go back to them again. That's the mind God wants you to have, so that that heavenly home, you will get there. I said that heavenly home, you will get there. But if your life is all surrounded by this, you don't even know where to put your feet, you don't know how to move around, because this one is there, this one is there, that one is there, whatever message you are hearing, it will not do anything at all in the positive. You might cry, you might shout, get rid of these six. Come out of this place and get out of those things that will tie you down, and be able to say, like Paul the apostle, I have counted them as dung and as dross. You might have to change your friends. You might have to change your associates. You might have to lock up yourself and say, no, I am not going to give in to that. I heard of a woman. She was about to get married, and this woman knew that the man she was to get married to was not the proper person, a criminal. But she had so much attachment to this man that every time she will say, I cannot marry this man, I cannot marry this man, I will not marry this man, and any